The truth is that God turns away from his own people. How is that possible? We're going to talk about that. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. My name is Rod Hembree.
And I'm Janice.
And this is Quick Study Television. It is a television program designed to take you through the Bible in 1 year, from Genesis 1 to Revelation 22. We're very excited about that. And Corey is here to tell us what she's doing. Corey?
Today we are going to be taking a look at the nation of Babylon rising during the days of Jeremiah.
Excellent. Very good. Look forward to that, Corey. What did you do?
Well, today we're going to talk about the cost to Jeremiah.
The cost to Jeremiah. That is excellent. Also, Ryan is here to tell us what he's doing. Ryan?
Today in our study of ancient man, we're back in China to look at a very impressively built tomb. In fact, it's said to be the tomb of China's first emperor.
All right, very good. I look forward to that. We have a lot to study. There's a lot to do on this program. So get your Bible and your Bible guide out, and let's get ready because it's time to go.
Today, our reading comes from the Old Testament book of the prophet Jeremiah. So today, you and I are going to be taking a look at some of the world politics that directly influenced Jeremiah's life and the life of the kings that he prophesied to. So we're right, this time period is extremely documented. We're right at this great time in history where we have the records of the Assyrian kings, the Babylonian kings, and Israel. Take a look.
The last kings and prophets of the southern nation of Judah lived in a time of great change for the ancient Middle East. The Assyrian Empire was weakening, and Chaldean kings dreamed of recreating the splendor of Babylon, ushering in what historians call the Neo-Babylonian Empire. Under Sennacherib of Assyria, the Chaldean rebel king Merodach-Baladan, who is mentioned in the Bible, died. But far from giving the Assyrian kings relief, Merodach-Baladan's descendants kept rebelling. The Chaldean king who finally succeeded against Assyria is believed to have been a great-nephew. This king's name was Nebuchadnezzar. In 627 BC, he marched on the Assyrian-controlled city of Babylon and took it. Like a slow, unstoppable wave, Nebuchadnezzar, with his son and general Nebuchadnezzar, began taking city after city, framing their victories not as takeovers, but as liberations from Assyrian power. To accomplish his plans, Nebuchadnezzar had made an alliance with the king of the Medes and Persians. They would fight side by side, defeat Assyria, and split the conquered territory. They sealed the deal by joining their families in marriage, the crowned prince and general Nebuchadnezzar, and the Median princess Amytis. Their endeavors worked. 14 years later, with much Assyrian territory under their belts, they besieged and thoroughly destroyed the Assyrian capital city, Nineveh, a victory prophesied by the biblical prophet Nahum. The king of Assyria managed to regroup and planned to meet up with the Egyptian army at Carchemish to make a last stand. At this point, biblical history intersects. Jerusalem's king Josiah attempted to stop Necho II, pharaoh of Egypt, from reaching Carchemish. Long a vassal of Assyria, it was in Jerusalem's best interest to stop Assyria's backup. 605 BC was a big year for Crown Prince Nebuchadnezzar. He destroyed Assyria in battle, sent the Egyptians running home scared, and claimed the Babylonian throne after his father's death. Nebuchadnezzar was now king of the Neo-Babylonian Empire. The beginning of the end had arrived for the kings of Jerusalem.
When you have a better understanding of the politics of the day, of Jeremiah's day, you begin to develop a new appreciation, a deeper appreciation for just how unpopular the message of the prophet of Jeremiah would have been. Remember, Jeremiah was a royal prophet. He wasn't just a prophet of God. He had the ears of the kings of Jerusalem who were trying to survive. They were trying to figure out a way for Judah and Jerusalem, their nation, their people, to survive to the next generation and to prosper. And they wanted to be free. That was their idea. And it makes sense. I mean, think about you right now. You want your nation to be free, but they had a covenant with God that they had ignored. And Jeremiah's message was that God was bringing in correction. He was bringing in a time of punishment because of their complete rejection of the original covenant that they had made with God and some of the actions of earlier kings that had brought in idolatry, and the people just kept this snowball rolling and it kept getting bigger and bigger. This snowball of idolatry, if you go with me on that metaphor. But Jeremiah's message of this surrender to Babylon was extremely, extremely unpopular, because here are the kings of Judah and Jerusalem who are responsible for the welfare of the people. And essentially, Jeremiah is saying, well, you can't. You just have to give up and you have to go with the correction of God. And, you know, the more we read through the book of the prophet, you're going to see just how unpopular this really was.
A time will come when the Lord turns away from those who once served him. Now, this has happened more times in history than we would expect. Each generation is a new group. Some in the Western world have chosen to reject the message of God and his church. Every generation must choose who they will follow as God and live with the results of their choices. But the Lord does not simply abandon them. He tells them what to expect and why if they listen to him. Jeremiah 16 is one passage where the Lord speaks to people about what to expect and why. At the end of his statement, God tells them what will happen to them. He says, quote, "Therefore I will cast you out of this land into a land that you do not know, neither you nor your fathers," close quote. Jeremiah 16, 13.
Jeremiah 16, verses 1 through 13. The word of the Lord also came to me, saying, "You shall not take a wife, nor shall you have sons or daughters in this place. For thus says the Lord concerning the sons and daughters who are born in this place, and concerning their mothers who bore them, and their fathers who begot them in this land. They shall die gruesome deaths. They shall not be lamented, nor shall they be buried, but they shall be like refuse on the face of the earth. They shall be consumed by the sword and by famine, and their corpses shall be meat for the birds of heaven and for the beasts of the earth. For thus says the Lord, do not enter the house of mourning, nor go to lament or bemoan them. For I have taken away my peace from this people, says the Lord, loving kindness and mercies. Both the great and the small shall die in this land. They shall not be buried. Neither shall men lament for them, cut themselves, nor make themselves bald for them. Nor shall men break bread in mourning for them to comfort them for the dead. Nor shall men give them the cup of consolation to drink for their father or their mother. Also you shall not go into the house of feasting to sit with them to eat and drink. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will cause to cease from this place before your eyes and in your days the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride. And it shall be when you show this people all these words, and they say to you, why has the Lord pronounced all this great disaster against us? Or what is our iniquity? Or what is our sin that we have committed against the Lord our God? Then you shall say to them, because your fathers have forsaken me, says the Lord, they have walked after other gods and have served them and worshiped them and have forsaken me and have not kept my law. And you have done worse than your fathers, for behold, each one follows the dictates of his own evil heart, so that no one listens to me. Therefore, I will cast you out of this land into a land that you do not know, neither you nor your fathers, and there you shall serve other gods day and night, where I will not show you favor. Jeremiah chapter 16, verses 1 through 13.
We continue going through the book of Jeremiah, and as we do that, we learn some interesting things. Now, Jeremiah has sacrificed himself to be the prophet in a very difficult time. This is the time when the people are changing, the environment has changed, and God's people are really not anymore. The priest and the prophets and all of that are really not. And God begins to speak through Jeremiah and through Ezekiel and others. And he says in chapter 16, listen carefully, "The word of the Lord that came to me," Jeremiah says, "the word of the Lord that came to me, you shall not take for yourself a wife, nor shall you have sons or daughters in this place." Now that is amazing. Think that through. He says to Jeremiah, you're not going to have sons or daughters. You're not going to have any family because this is a time when judgment will come. Now, that's very important. Turn your Bible guide to today's passage as we look at it and consider it. If you don't have your Bible guide, I want to encourage you to write to us at the bottom of the screen. The Bible guide is one way that we encourage you to respond to the program to help us pay our bills and all of that, our electric and our heating bills and everything else. It's very important that you hear from God. So pray and ask God what He would have you do and do that. You can also go to BibleDiscoveryTV.com. And when you go there, click on Donate Here, make a donation in any amount. That is great. We've seen the donations rise there, and thank you so much for doing that. It is very, very important. Now, with our ways of truth, we begin to study Jeremiah chapter 16. And the only way to really title this is to say, God turns away. God turns away? This is where God has His temple. This is the place where God has everything that He established on the earth through King David and many others. Now, God turns away. We're going to read Jeremiah 14 to 16 as we keep up through the Word of God, through the Bible, and keeping it in our hearts and our minds. We're looking today at Jeremiah 16, verses 1 through 13. Let's pray and ask God for wisdom. Father, I pray today, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that You would speak to our hearts, to the people who are watching on the internet, the people who are watching on the telephones, and the people who are watching on television. Speak to them, O God, and help them to hear what You say. Help me to hear what You say as well, and to do it, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen. The first verse says, "The word of the Lord also came to me, saying, you shall not take a wife, nor shall you have sons or daughters in this place. For thus says the Lord concerning the sons and the daughters who are born in this place, and concerning their mothers who bore them and their fathers who begot them in the land. They shall die gruesome deaths. They shall not be lamented, nor shall they be buried, but they shall be like refuse on the face of the earth. They shall be consumed by the sword and by famine, and their corpses shall be meat for the birds of the heaven and for the beast of the earth." Boy, what an indictment. That's amazing. God was told not to, or Jeremiah was told not to marry or have children because the future was bleak. We must listen to God when God speaks to us. God has spoken to us in these times, beloved. These are the times when things are messing up and turning around and the world is kind of crazy. God spoke to Israel and He speak to us today. And God tells us very important things. He says, don't be deceived. That's going to be a theme I'm going to carry on in the next few days because deception is critical. We must read the Word of God and know it so we understand it. I can't do so many things to try to get you to read the Bible. I just have to encourage you, read the Bible. We're going to read it again in the second part of the passage. It says, "For thus says the Lord, do not enter the house of mourning, nor go to lament or bemoan them, for I have taken away my peace," God's peace, "from this people, says the Lord. Loving kindness and mercies, both the great and the small shall die in this land. They shall not be buried, neither shall men lament for them. cut themselves, nor make themselves bald for them. These were the procedures of people who passed away, and that's what they would do. Verse 7 says, nor shall men break bread in mourning for them to comfort them for the dead, nor shall men give them the cup of consolation to drink for their father or their mother. Things would change, beloved. See, conditions change for those who die. There will be no funerals. There will be no burials. Why? God has given us a way to trust in Him if we listen to Him. There's only one way I can say it. Listen to the Word of God. The Bible tells us the truth about what Jesus Christ said. He came and died on the cross for our sins. We need to return to the Lord and we need to serve Him. Very important today. Let's go on to this last passage. Verse 8 says, also you shall not go into the house of feasting to sit with them, to eat and to drink. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will cause to cease from this place. I will cause to cease from this place before your eyes in your days the voice of myrrh or mirth and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride. And it shall be when you show this people all these words that they say to you, why has the Lord pronounced all this great disaster against us? Or what is our iniquity? Or what is our sin that we have committed against the Lord our God? Then you shall say to them, because your fathers have forsaken me, says the Lord. They have walked after their other gods and have served them and worshiped them and have forsaken them or forsaken me and not kept my law. And you have done worse than your fathers. For behold, each one follows the dictates of his own evil heart, so that no one listens to me. No one listens to me. Therefore, I will cast you out of this land into a land that you do not know, neither you nor your fathers, and there you shall serve other gods day and night, and where I will not show you favor. Now listen, this is important. Times changed during Jeremiah's ministry. God removed the joy and feasting and sent the people to another land. God will turn away from loving us and helping us. God is not here to just make us have a good time, beloved. This life is war, and our condition is battle. We must understand that Jesus Christ is the ultimate source of our strength. Jeremiah is called to take a flask from a potter. This is interesting. As we look at this, we're going to study what that means and how he presents it. Next time on Quick Study Television, make sure that you're there because we'll be here. Ryan?
Well, today's report would make an awesome Indiana Jones movie because we're headed to China to explore a very ancient tomb, which is believed to belong to their very first emperor. In fact, some believe his body still remains there undisturbed. Also, according to ancient descriptions, within the tomb are amazing and wondrous treasures. However, entry has been and remains to be strictly forbidden. Even if one could enter the tomb, it might be rigged with deadly traps. One thing is clear, this very ancient tomb complex was designed by very intelligent human beings with a purpose. Despite the fact that China is amongst the oldest nations of the world, being settled less than 1,000 years after Babel, it did not become a great nation until Ying Zhen rose to power around 250 BC. For up until this time, China, having been made up of several sovereign states, lacked unity. But when Zhen inherited his father's throne in 246 BC, at the young age of 13, he purposed in his heart to unify China. It would take several years of military campaigns. However, by 221 BC, he had unified six warring states and took the name Qin Shi Huangdi, which means the first emperor of China. Not only did Qin take control of most of China, but he also set up a lasting and organized empire. In addition, he standardized coins, weights, and measures throughout China, as well as a writing system. He also built roads and canals to increase the flow and rate at which trade was conducted. His network of roads stretched approximately 4,000 miles and included some roads up to 40 feet wide, complete with a lane reserved for royal members. He is also credited with building the first version of the Great Wall. Yet of all of Qin's building projects, the one that most intrigues historians is his now famous mausoleum, which he ordered built soon after his rise to power. Though he apparently died before its completion, the massive tomb has been described as one of the greatest examples in China of both ancient man's intellect and his pride. Indeed, towering high over the landscape at nearly 400 feet is a man-made mound almost as large as the Great Pyramid in Egypt. On the ground level, there are 30-foot walls dividing the site into the inner and outer cities, as well as mausoleum complexes. But really, it is what lies beneath the surface that fascinates modern-day historians, because according to ancient descriptions, the massive underground chamber, equal to 580 basketball courts, is filled with incredible treasures, including replicas of palaces and scenic towers, rare utensils and wonderful objects, rivers of mercury, pavilions of gold, and even pearls on the ceiling representing the heavenly bodies. All of this, of course, is supposedly guarded by crossbows rigged to shoot anyone who tries to break in. Although the main tomb containing the emperor has yet to be opened, and entry into the tomb is currently forbidden, modern archaeologists have located the tomb and have inserted probes deep into it. Significantly, these probes revealed abnormally high quantities of mercury, some 100 times the naturally occurring rate, suggesting that some parts of the description are credible. While there are still many unknowns regarding Qin's mausoleum, there is no question that its ancient builders were fully intelligent and capable human beings, just like we are today. You know, it's my hope and prayer that as we've been exploring the cultures and technology of ancient man over the last several weeks, you've been able to clearly see that all these people were fully capable and intelligent human beings, just like you and me. They were not less evolved as the pop science of the day would have us believe. In reality, the Chinese, just like the other cultures, came out of Babel. And before that, all people were one and spoke the same language. And every one of us come from Noah and from Adam and Eve before him. And Adam and Eve were created by God, fully human and fully capable from the beginning. There is no evolution, and that's what history, true history, confirms.
And that's what we're finding out, Ryan, when we look at this from around the world. We can do that now because we have the internet and we have ways of communicating with individuals and people who
are
around the world.
It's much easier now.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. And yeah. I mean, in your segments, you got access to a lot of information from around the world and a lot of people and a lot of experiences. And then you, of course, have access with a lot of experiences, of course, around the world. This is one of the reasons that we do this, is because we're taking advantage of all of the things we have. Mm-hmm. We're putting it together inside this program so people can get a glimpse of the amazing, stunning historical facts that are in this book.
It really is a great time to study the Bible, to want to read it and understand it. It's an amazing time because of all the information that is available.
Ancient scholars would have loved this.
Yes.
Are you kidding
yes.
me? They, I mean, think about that.
Can you
that.
Imagine that? Yeah. Mm.
We have the fingerprints of Barak. We have, I mean, it's amazing. Like, I mean, he didn't have registration then, but I mean, can you imagine that? I mean, that's stunning.
It really is.
And that we have his fingerprint off a thumb seal. But
a signet seal, yeah.
It's interesting how that we have all this stuff now, and it's almost like God realize that we would be doubting the Bible in this time and we would be questioning it. So it's like he saved all his information for now. Mm-hmm. And like Caiaphas's tomb, you know, that's a first century priest, high priest, and his bones were inside.
They were. They sure
were. It seems like almost every week there's some new discovery that they're like, oh, look, this is... We found this, and this is what the Bible says, and hey, look, it matches.
Well, in the last 150 years, really, this field of archaeological research has exploded when it comes to ancient Israel and the Middle East, and just the amount of information being pulled out of the ground is huge. And, you know, it's able to confirm that the Bible is a very good witness of history. Mm-hmm. So.
It truly is. It really is. Anyway, what did you study today?
Well, it kind of goes hand in hand. I'm sitting here smiling because I'm thinking about Jeremiah. If he had known that we would be sitting here some thousand years ahead, you know, in advanced in time, reading his book and to thousands of people, and thinking, Ryan, I remember you mentioning some time ago that you could hardly wait to meet Jeremiah in heaven, mm-hmm. because you said you just want to hug him.
Yeah.
For all that he went through. And that's kind of what I wanted to touch on, that Jeremiah truly loved the God of his fathers, and it truly became his God. Because, you know, there's so much evidence throughout the book, but especially in chapter 15, we learn that he is isolated, that he's lonely, and that he's writing about it. And then, you know, our hearts are already feeling badly. And if you want to look up those verses, you can read that in chapter 15, verse 10, where he's isolated and where he's writing about being lonely in verse 17. And then we get into chapter 16 and we find out that the Lord does not want him to marry or to have children, which is a really unusual request, mm-hmm. of an Israelite man to not marry. This was a very unusual position, but yet he could understand because of what was coming. Yeah. God did not want to put him or his any future children through what was going to be happening. But then also we hear about funeral feasts and not going to any kind of special meals. We read about that later. So he really did become like a social outcast, mm-hmm. for God. But yet his life was a solid testimony. And I too, Ryan, look forward to meeting Jeremiah one day. And it's a good reminder for us when we go through those times, whether it be in our family, whether it be in our community or at work, when we feel a bit of a social outcast because of our beliefs in God, hold on. Just hold on, because God is with us and God is good and he sees our life, and we need to live and be thankful for every moment that he gives us.